So this morning, we will be looking at King Solomon. King Solomon spent most of his life finding pleasure apart from God. So before we get into that in the scripture, I want to share with you an experience from one of my friends on what he went through that is very, very, very similar to King Solomon's life. So years ago, I met someone by the name of Chris. This man seemed to have it all. He graduated college, and he entered the corporate world, and he found out how powerful knowledge is, and how in the workplace, and the more knowledge he obtained, the more money he could make, right? That does make sense, and there's nothing wrong with making a lot of money, but you'll soon see why it was a problem. He attempted to earn his master's so he could make more money, because money was all of a sudden his biggest focus. Chris always had to have the best of the best items or things. He told me last week that if he had a TV that didn't need fixed, or appliances, or similar things, he would just go out and buy them because he had the money, right? Did he need these new things? Did they need repaired? No. He had the money, so he went and bought some of the most expensive things for his house. Speaking of his house, he had to have the biggest house, the best truck. He spent a lot of money, he told me, when he could have easily bought an $8,000 or $10,000 car for himself, but he had to have the best of the best. This man was searching for happiness and material things. He spent most of his money on things he did not need whatsoever. Alcohol slowly began to be a problem for him. He started off being a casual drinker, and then it ended up to every day, whether at home or with his friends. And I asked him, I said, so how much would you spend in alcohol a week? I mean, I have no idea, right? Like $50, $60 if you're going out to a bar or something. And he said he would spend about $150 to $200 a week in alcohol alone. When he consumed this alcohol, he was able to find happiness because it numbed the pain and it took away the stress in his life. But soon he realized that this happiness that he found in the alcohol was only temporary, and therefore he needed to find something else, right? Once you try something and then the feeling's lost, you go to something else, right? So what did this man do? He turned to lust. He did a lot of things that he should not have been doing, especially at the time when he was married. So after searching for happiness in many different places, he continued to feel empty inside. So this morning we're going to look at a similar story about what King Solomon discovered during his lifetime when searching for happiness, when searching for pleasure apart from God. Solomon's perspective is something that we as Christians, we should study, we should understand, as well as appreciate Solomon's words to us. Let's get a little backstory just briefly on King Solomon, real quickly, and also the book of Ecclesiastes. One of a few that he did write. So the book of Ecclesiastes was written by King Solomon, the son of David and Bathsheba, and he was the third king over Israel. After Solomon became king, the Lord sent to him in 1 Kings. He said, "Ask for whatever you want me to give you." At that moment, God was going to give him anything his heart desired, his heart wanted, right? If God were to ask you that question today, what would you ask for? anything. Okay, peace. What else? What would God, let me hear a couple more. What would you ask? God is right here today. I will give you anything you want. What would he give you?
Health.
Peace.
Happiness.
So what did Solomon choose, right? Solomon chose for wisdom. Solomon wanted a discerning heart, the heart of God, so he could make right decisions and lead the nation well. King Solomon ended up leading Israel for 40-something years. He did amazing things for the Lord. I could not tell you how many things he did, he accomplished, he achieved for the Lord in the amount of time I have. But with that being said, he made many poor decisions. He, during these 40 years, you know what? During his lifetime, when he was searching for meaning, for happiness, for pleasure, he ended up searching for things apart from God. So throughout Solomon's life, Solomon turned to worldly pleasure instead of pursuing God. Yes, he did pursue God most of his time, but there was also that human side of him, right, who finds pleasure in other things, and he did so away from God. Solomon tried four things, and we're going to go through those real quick. The first thing Solomon tried to look for apart from God was a life of luxury. Solomon looked into material things to fill the void that was within his heart. He wanted to feel happiness. He wanted to feel pleasure. Just not the happiness and pleasure that God gives, right? He wanted to look outside of God on this earth. What on this earth would give me pleasure? So he sought luxury. This man could buy anything he wanted with the amount of wealth he had, right? So I'm thinking to myself, so how much wealth did he really have, right? Some believe that his wealth, what he was valued at, totaled $2 trillion. Trillion with a T. I had to read, I'm like, okay, how are you getting these numbers? Because I don't even believe that. But it's a huge possibility that he had $2 trillion, that he was worth that amount, all right? Currently, Jeff Bezos, who's the founder, CEO of Amazon, is said to be currently the richest man in the world with well over $100 billion. That is 5% of what Solomon had. So if that puts you into perspective, if that puts this into perspective at all, you know, I know a lot of us, I know myself, even when I get $1,000, I'm like, oh, praise God, this money is going to go to pay bills or to do something fun. If I were to get $1 million, I would have been like, I don't even know what to do with that. And then if I were to get $1 billion, I'd be like, okay, this is just ridiculous. I don't even know what to do with that, right? But trillion, that is just unheard of. Solomon had gold and silver, among other things, delivered to him on a regular basis. If he wanted to build anything his heart desired, he would build it. He built the first temple in Jerusalem, as well as many palaces. He had the finest horses and chariots. I don't know anybody who has a horse, let alone a chariot, but he had the best of the horses as well as chariots. He had 40,000 stalls for his horses. He had 12,000 horsemen. He had great possession of cattle. And just to get an idea, I don't even know if this would make sense to you, but the amount of cattle in Jerusalem, he had more than that. So I'm guessing that was quite a bit. If he wanted to do anything, he did it. Money was no objection. Think about that for a moment. You could buy anything you want at any given time and have that same mindset for the rest of your life. But at what point would that life of luxury be too much, eventually unfulfilling, and without pleasure? I'm not talking about day one, day two, day three. Man, that would be crazy. But I'm talking about years from then. That's got to get old. From his search for the life of luxury, right? King Solomon wrote this in Ecclesiastes 2:1. I do apologize for not having slides. I thought it would just be a lot easier for myself and those in sound to just kind of focus on God's words that he put through me. I will read out the verse, the chapter and verse, in case you do want to write that down or try and follow along with me. But in Ecclesiastes 2:11, Solomon writes, "Yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had worked to achieve, everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained under the sun." Solomon found luxury was unfulfilling. Wow. Well, this is embarrassing. Shell, would you mind looking in my, sorry guys, would you mind looking in my office? I'm missing a page. I printed off a copy. Can you see if there's any copies on where the live stream goes, please? Solomon tried lust. I'm going to skip ahead a little bit. Solomon tried lust, okay? Solomon ended up having 700 wives and 300 concubines. Some men may think this is the good life. Not me. I think that is very, 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 very icky. I'm just going to be completely honest with you. Keep in mind that this means there are 700 birthdays to celebrate. So I actually took it one step further and thought, okay, if there's 700 birthdays, let's just say there's two birthdays a day. Okay. Solomon had to sing happy birthday to them, right? So Solomon was having about two parties a day singing happy birthday to these wives. So then I took it a step further. I'm thinking, how the heck does he know the names of all these wives? If he's singing happy birthday to them, how is that even possible? So I thought again. I'm thinking maybe what he did was he sang, and I'm not going to sing, I'm going to say it, okay? Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday, dear my wife, happy birthday to you. There is no possible way he could have remembered those names, right? So many of Solomon's wives were foreigners. This problem lured King Solomon away from the Lord. And he even started worshiping false gods and idols. He let these wives also worship their native gods and even had altars to those gods built in Jerusalem. That's in 1 Kings 11. In regards to these women, King Solomon says in Ecclesiastes 7, "I find more bitter than death is a woman who is a snare, whose heart is a trap, and whose hands are chains. The man who pleases God will escape her, but the sinner she will ensnare. Solomon realized that lust for more than one woman, that's my words, did not fill the void of happiness, of pleasure that his heart desired. Solomon also tried learning. Solomon discovered about luxury. That didn't do anything for him, so what else could I do? You know what? Learning. Why don't I try to acquire the knowledge that is above everybody? I want to learn as much as I possibly can. And he ended up being the best student. He became a teacher to many, and as well as writing several books in the Bible. The problem he faced when obtaining knowledge was that knowledge he gained was never enough. In Ecclesiastes 1, chapter 13, he writes, "I applied my mind to study and to explore by wisdom all that is done under the sun." That is everything. He continued in verse 18. He says that he comes to the realization, "For much wisdom comes much sorrow." The more knowledge, the more grief. That was hard for me to understand, right? So I did some searching, and some believe that this verse is referring to the state in which one sees the corruption of the world, right? The more you study, let's take, for example, history. The more you study history, the more depressing it does get. If you were to study World War II, the Civil War, stuff like that, all of a sudden your picture of life may contain some sorrow or depression on what went through in the past and what would possibly come in the future. The more Solomon learned about this world, the more depressing he came. He poured his time, he poured his energy in learning everything about everything. But this, once again, did not bring him the peace, the happiness that he was searching for. He was once again chasing after the wind. He was unfulfilled. The last thing Solomon tried was liquor. Since the others did not work, he drank not just alcohol, he turned to alcohol, and not just as a casual drinker, but he was quite the partier. He threw some amazing parties, right? But for him to turn to liquor to find pleasure, that made no sense to me. Because from my personal experience, this seems to do the opposite effect, all right? When drinking alcohol, there seems to be more problems that it can create instead of finding answers, right? So being that wealthy that Solomon was, we heard how much money he has, the beautiful palaces that he has, he would throw elegant parties. And not just drink alone, but he would drink with others, and this would last forever. We have some kids, teens here. All right, so let me put this, because you guys are like, okay, I don't get any of this right now. So let me put this to where you guys could understand, all right? Let's say you guys throw a party. You get your friends over, no parents. You get your friends over at 7 o'clock. You guys buy Mountain Dew and energy drinks, Starbucks. I don't know, I think that covers everything, maybe. And then you get an endless supply of snacks, your favorite snacks, right? What do you do while drinking the energy and then the caffeine, all that stuff, and get your snacks? You're going to play Fortnite or Among Us. Am I right? Is there any other games you guys play? Okay, some people are like, what in the world is that? That's probably the two most popular video games or apps on your phone. That's all that kids play, it seems like. They're good, just a couple killings. But other than that, great games, right? So let's say you guys do this not one night, not two nights, but you guys do it for 30 straight nights, okay? How does that feel if you guys were to do that 30 straight nights? I'm not going to let you guys answer that. I'm going to answer that for you guys. That would get boring. It would have to get boring, right? My brother and I play video games all day on Mondays on my day off. I don't know if I could do that on Tuesday because we just spent so much time. It would lose that feel. It probably wouldn't. We would probably do it Tuesday too. But Wednesday, no. We would stop right there, right? I guarantee you it will eventually get old. And this is what Solomon ran into. This got old. Partying got old. Drinking liquor, the fine wines, everything that they had some 2,000 years ago. He lost that enjoyment, the pleasure that it once brought him. We read in Proverbs, Solomon does talk about this. Solomon talks about what he found. He discovered that wine is a mocker and strong drink a brawler. Whoever is led astray by them is not wise. This is what he learned after trying to find pleasure in alcohol. What did Solomon finally do? That was four things Solomon tried, right? I'm sure there was other things that he tried as well, but those were the four big things that Solomon tried, that is through the book of Ecclesiastes. So what did he do next? He finally turned to the Lord. Finally turned back to the Lord. After trying to find happiness through luxury, through learning, through liquor, through lust, Solomon realized, he found out that the only true happiness, the only true pleasure in life is found in the Lord. Solomon, he finally comes to this realization that life is empty. It is meaningless apart from God, right? Sorry to throw that at you. It's like January 3rd or 4th, and I'm telling you that everything's meaningless. You know, what a way to start the new year. That's not what I'm implying. Let's see what else he finds out. The book of Ecclesiastes teaches that life can be full of disappointment when we look for this happiness apart from God. Solomon teaches us to find pleasure in God and in God alone, and to stop looking for pleasure within the world, pleasure underneath the sun. King Solomon's actions apart from God speak loudly to us in our current day materialistic world, right? When we worship possessions or earthly pleasures over God, we will be let down. Just read Ecclesiastes. We're going to get let down just like Solomon did. One definition, I was looking up the definition of pleasure, because when I put pleasure in the title, and then when I put when I was reading Solomon, he uses the word pleasure quite a bit. So I'm like, all right, so what exactly does pleasure mean? So when you look up on dictionary.com, there's like three or four meanings. The third meaning, I'm like, oh my gosh. The third meaning that they define pleasure is worldly enjoyment. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, this is exactly what we're talking about. This is exactly what Solomon is chasing after. Instead of searching for heavenly enjoyment, Solomon focused on earthly, worldly enjoyment. His mind was wrapped around so many things under the sun instead of heaven, instead of the heavenly things, instead of the godly things. I cannot think enough how Solomon is relatable to myself, to us. When we want happiness, when we're searching for pleasure, we try so many things, right? I'm guilty of it. We're all guilty of it. But in the end, when we search the world, when we search all of the temporary pleasures in the world, we finally turn to the Lord. So here's a question. Why don't we turn to the Lord in the first place? We read Solomon. Why is it so difficult to just skip these steps or avoid those steps and just say, Lord, all I need is you? Here's what I realized in doing this message and reading Ecclesiastes in detail over the past several weeks. I think everybody needs to take the path that Solomon took to find this heavenly pleasure. Maybe not these exact steps, but similar. Maybe you have already took Solomon's path, or maybe you're walking in that path right now. In closing, let's remember this. When you find pleasure in God and in God alone, you will be freed from the need to find pleasure in the world around you, which will lead to great fulfillment, peace in your relationships with one another, and a fruitfulness in your life. So let's start off the new year on the right foot by getting to know God more on a personal level. What does that look like, right? Getting to know God on a personal level, praying with God, be in prayer. Set aside 5 minutes of your time to just talk to God. That's what prayer is. That's what we say all the time. People are like, I don't know how to pray. Do you know how to talk? Yeah, all right, do that to God. It is that simple. Talk to God, right? Meditate on His Word. When I first heard that, I'm thinking, meditation, that's like different religions. I'm not that religion. I'm a Christian. I don't need to meditate. What is that about? No, yeah, you do. Meditation looks different from Christianity to the other religions. Meditation is just being in a room, being quiet, listening to God, appreciating God for what He's given you, appreciating God for Jesus Christ. That's what meditation's about, right? Just giving God your time, your mind, your heart. And also maybe even start a devotional. We talk about also how easy it is to start devotionals. There are apps on your phone. There are free apps on your phone where there's 5 or 10 minute devotionals, 3 days a week, 5 days a week, 30 days. Do one of those. Do whatever you can to strengthen or even to start your relationship with God today. Not tomorrow, not the next day, but today. Yes, it's January 3rd. It doesn't have to be January 1st when you start it. Start it today, all right? Get to know God more on a personal level. And in case you were wondering, I began the message with my friend Chris. I kind of left you on a cliffhanger, like, oh my gosh, what happened to him? Is he okay? My friend Chris, after being in the hospital with a blood alcohol level of 0.75, turned to the Lord. And I could not believe that. I'm like, dude, you got your numbers messed up. It was like 0.25. It wasn't 0.75. It was 0.75. 0.75 was his blood alcohol level. That's what it took him to turn to Christ. And now he lives a life devoted for Christ, forgetting about the material things. And now he finds pleasure in Christ and Christ alone. So let's pray together, please. Father God, thank you for the message that you've placed on my heart, Lord. I pray that we all can understand how important pleasure, happiness, fulfillment in you, looks like, Lord. Help us not to focus on the world, on what the world gives us. Help us to turn to you in times where we do struggle with materialism, with lust, with liquor, with even furthering our education or learning. It's okay on a couple of those things to do, Lord, but we need to make sure that our focus is around you, Lord. Lord, thank you for this time, Lord, and in your Son's name we all pray. Amen.